So in the second lecture of the third module, we are going to continue the topic from the first lecture, but with a special emphasis on the aspect of visual communication and the concept of communication in a social purpose. So in our study, let's see how the whole practice are connected socially. It's more like they're connected to the daily rituals for different worships, for the new harvest, for anything that is auspicious. So we talked about transforming a common or general ordinary space into a special space. That is what is connected to its context, and how they're transforming that space to the ordinary space to a special space is by means of decoration. So the paintings, they have some decorative qualities into it. The craft, the other modelings, they also have some decorative qualities to it, but they're just not mere decorations. So when we call them the decorative art, they're not decorations for the sake of it. They're connected with the customary rites, the rituals and everything else, but there is some feeling of transferring it and make it auspicious that works as the primary factor that was prevalent for it. And right now, maybe it's not so much connected to the rituals and the customary and habitual behavior. Rather, they're working as a style. So if the style in the beginning were decorative, it has to have some decorative qualities to maintain the identity of that particular genre. So when we see that there are decorations in that tradition, which is also leaving tradition in contemporary mode, we feel that the decorative quality is still giving us some identity of its own. However, like in the society, they had certain role to be played throughout, which is not so important anymore. There are alternatives, mediums, and there is a paradigm shift, because if we look back and look at the basic purpose of this kind of practices, then what we can understand is that it was part of a performance. Most of the time it was connected, the kind of art that got generated, they were connected with some ritualistic performances, and it was connected to the temple traditions, where most of the things were meant or prepared for the purpose of the temples. And there had been roving minstrels, the Kathaks or the priests, who were the basic guides to make the painters work on it. So most of the time the painters would work on all those backdrops or the images that was used as the pichwai or the backdrop paintings in a temple as a backdrop of some idol. And later, those who are not able to visit the temple, they can carry those images to the general households and tell the stories of the epics and all auspicious happenings, even that included some fables, folk tales, and also some stories were connected to moral aspects only to educate people. There had been tendencies to generate moral values, to propagate certain theories. It was all meant for some purposes, for social communication, for a very long time. And it involved a lot of things together. It was a complete expression. It was not only painting or making some images, but rather it came with some orations, some stories, some dance, some performances. It also needed for the ambience, to enhance the ambience by choosing a particular time of the day to do all these things. So it was all connected to the performance and the rites as such. So that way it played a very vital role into the society to keep them engaged in their extra hour. So it was not only entertainment but enrichment in their leisures, and was part of their daily rituals in that way. But right now it got replaced by many other modes of recreation, and also because of the cross media and the cross cultural exchanges, the expression of folk art took its own turn. It has changed, it has come with a new face rather. So that way the communication aspect of folk art has reduced to a different level. And we see it that there are certain things which are also communicative, but they're basically having some emphasis on the visual communication. It's a visual storytelling that takes place even when it's a ekachitra or a single framed picture that is made in the, like when we see that it's made, it may not be made by a painter who belonged to a painter's family. But those who are practicing or picking up those artworks to emphasize on the style and technique of it. So their expressions as artists are getting conveyed through this medium, which is working as a genre or a visual style of its own. And that is the interesting factor that we see, that from the social communication to it's getting a very different outlook. But everything is connected to the society and culture at the end of it. The painters over ages have been performing the role of a reformer by promoting the flair of rectitude in the minds of the common populace, not as a preacher but entertainer, with their artistic ability of painting and singing. In 2007, Shakuntala Ramani writes, "The meaning of art is similarly a mystic experience for which one needs Divya Chakshu, the inner perception. For understanding Indian traditional art, or for that matter any art form, one needs divine vision to understand the message of the artist beyond the outer image. In the inner is the inner meaning, which can be perceived and shared both by the artist and the viewer. It is by vision, the shared experience, that reveals the soul of art. But in many instances, what we see now, that the art is losing its soul. So it's very important that regardless of all its purposes, the soul has to be preserved in the artistic expression. So if we restrict the artist to paint for some social causes, it may also undergo some kind of a predicament. There are dangers that these people may feel restricted. So it's another duty from us to see that the artists remains free, and then only the soul of the art can be maintained. Let's understand quite a few such happening with some artistic expression of the contemporary time, which are religious and traditional in nature. At the same time, the artist is using a lot of artistic freedom into it. They're the innovators, they're innovating new stories and seeing things from a traditional perspective, but in a very innovative and new term. So these are the kind of dream projects that they're taking up and showing a different level of understanding through their artworks. So let's see some images and try to understand that. Let me show you the documentation that I've done of one painting made by Shilpa Guru Anant Maharana of Raghurajpur, Odisha. That is seen in the picture, are almost in the finishing state. they needed a bit of a touch-up to complete it. So it was just kept on the floor, and we'll try to look at them, look at the image and understand how the communication through some images were done in social purpose. And now, and even then, it was not only meant for a propagation or anything, but the artist also took a lot of artistic freedom in its execution. So this aptitude for centralization is not limited to the standalone symmetrical composition. In this image of Ramayana inscribed on the body of Hanumana, that is shown in the picture, painted by, as I said, Shilpa Guru Anant Maharana in Raghurajpur, Odisha, one can observe, as it has been pointed out to the author by the artist's son, Bibhu Maharana, that all happy episodes are put on the face of Hanumana, while the episodes related to Ravana, the anti-hero of the epic, are drawn around the lower body of the Hanuman. The composition evoked a certain integrity, such as images being governed by pre-formulated and preconceived solutions. The style here is at its most expressive vibrancy. The considerable difference in the scale of Hanuman and the rest of the figures etched on his body in the formation of a tattoo-like formation to get the strike some kind of a increased and reduced formation to formulate severally repeated with little variation here and there. Let us see more images in detail from the same composition that will show us a obvious bend towards the Western Indian influences that they have in the folk paintings of Odisha, for some obvious reasons that all these artists and their ancestors, they have come from the Western India, from Rajasthan. They also have surnames as Maharana and Mahapatra. So they had some Western Indian cultural root that we may assume right now. So what we see here are different episodes of Ramayana. It's almost the whole Ramayana and the whole story that is depicted on some circular panels, circular form fragments all over in the body of the central character, which is Hanumana. And let's see how they're distributed through throughout in intricate and very, very congested composition, which is full of details. At the same time, because of its general symmetry, these asymmetries are getting supported by a symmetrical figure inside. So we can actually look at them from its symmetrical emphasis. At the same time, the narrative asymmetry and the use of allegories, symbols and narrations are very significant in this artwork. There are feelers in red linear pattern, which gives us a intricate formation of some pinkish, reddish, whitish decorative motifs, motifs in between. And according to the artist's son, Bibhu Maharana, they are the veins and arteries of Hanumana, and it shows that the blood that is flowing in the body, they're also auspicious, with some auspicious motifs. So he is the iconic great god who is the bhakt, the worshipper, who is the symbol of the person who is like carrying the whole story of Ramayana in his body. Let's see some other details. So mostly the demon, the Ravana and other demons, they are in the lower part of the body. And what we see in the center of the body are the happiest sins, especially the face has the happy events. So in the middle part, in the chest, what we see that he has taken out the inner part to show that Rama and Sita, the main characters, they're sitting at his own heart, and that is the kind of place where they're sitting is a lotus. And the lotus motif is getting continued as his vein all throughout. He's also wearing rings, and there are formations of the typographic formations in many different places which are working as typographic motifs throughout. All the frames are circular. And the face, what we see that these are the happy episodes that has taken place from the story, from the narrative. That's the face of Hanumana. And even in the eyes, in the iris, the eyeball, it has the images of Vishnu. And as we know, Rama, the central figure, is the incarnation of Vishnu. In the border, there are the same deity, Hanuman, in different dancing gestures throughout. That provides a lot of variation. So it's not just the decoration, but the kind of artistic expression and observation that is shown here is of a high quality stuff. Let's see another example from the Manisha Mangal Pattachitra of early 20th century Bengal. That is an example of a medieval narrative based on the popular Mangal Kavya tradition of Eastern India. It is probably archetypical of the Middle Ages, where the painter could afford to depend on the viewer's ability to recognize the characters on the basis of the attributes that accompanies it. For Manasa Mangal Kavya, the character of Manasa, the vindictive snake goddess, who is also not as important as the known goddesses, can be identified with a snake accompanying her in this picture. Manasa Mangal Pattachitra from Midnapur in Guru Sadadat Museum collection, collection number 182, is 8 feet by 1 feet 4.5 inches in size, made in 20th century, with entire story told here in 12 panels. It is important to observe that the storytelling in folk narrative paintings have some basic difference with the animation and graphic novel. The difference is most obvious in the storytelling of planning of a sequence where the repetitive movement is involved. In graphic novel, the idea of the happening is fragmented into many parts to pick up the most effective frames and the key frames to depict the active motion. In Pattachitra, the stories are popular and already known, causing the actions rather frozen, with no obvious climax, as it has some emphasis on the narrative quality of the visual. The most active frames are merged in continuous flow. Animations, on the other hand, are built up with fragments of effective dialogues and moving actions on frequent visual push and pulls in the composition. But they have some similarity in their characteristic, and if at all the language of Pattachitra has to change, then the shift of paradigm should also happen, can only happen in the form of graphic novel making. So, however, in this picture, we would like to see all the frames that are there, all the 12 panels that are documented, and we'll try to understand the story through it. So, in the first frame, we see goddess Manasa, who is a snake goddess, appearing in the picture with a snake, which is in a spiral order and quite a large one. Then in the next frame, which is continuous, and it is also shown at the lower part of this particular frame, I show that in the individual image in a zoomed in condition, where a group of Kirtaniya, or the roving singer devotees, they're singing and playing drums. And there's a character known Chad Sadagar, and his family, the main character, who refused to worship Manasa because she was the unimportant goddess, and he was the worshipper of Shiva, and he is the character who sacrificed because of his determination. And the story is built up with this rivalry between Chand Sadagar and Manasa. So we see Chand Sadagar and his family, and the marriage procession of Behula and Lakshinder. They are the Behula and Lakshinder. Lakshinder is the youngest son of Chand Sadagar, and he is getting married. In the third frame, what we see is Chand Sadagar, the largest figure, with the wife and the other family members, and then the marriage of Behula and Lakshinder. Before that, what happened that all the other sons of Chand Sadagar they were died already in snake bites, as Chand Sadagar refused to worship Manasa. So there was a curse in the family. And then in the next panel, what we see that the marriage procession of Behula and Lakshinder, where the black snake biting Lakshinder, Behula with the dead body of her husband Lakshinder floating on a bhala, and at the right side, Behula detailed at Goda, left Behula near ghat of Appu, Behula before Neta in the guise of a tiger, Behula before Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva in heaven, Chand Sadagar, his wife Sanaka, Behula and Lakshinder lying, and the river flowing, and Behula is carrying the dead body of his newlywed husband to the heaven through the river path. And Neta is the washer lady who is washing the clothes in one of the ghat thereby. So Chand Sadagar, his wife Sanaka, and seven sons of Chand Sadagar comes into life at the end frame, where the gods are pleased by Behula, and there's a goat sacrifice before goddess Manasa that took place. So we see the goat sacrifice before Manasa. Manasa is pleased by Behula's gestures, and finally the shipwrecks that took place as a curse that is recovered. And all the sons of Chand Sadagar, they came into life at the end of it. So, these stories are made and written for purely social purposes, to inject fears, fantasies, related to new gods and goddesses who came into the scene in the medieval Bengal as well as in the country in that particular time. So they wanted this kind of fears to be inserted into the common mind, that to popularize certain worships of the unimportant or the secondary important gods and goddesses in that time. So there are stories related to that, and there are amazing narratives, the literatures which were written in that age on the basis of the stories. For regular oration, it was part of the ritualistic tradition where there had been the part and puja, means the reading of those texts with the images, and also the worships with some ritualistic customary rites that took place in the society, and that was meant for public gathering, that there would be people from different households who would meet at some point and read the story together and get the moral out of it, and then to remember that for a very long time. There had been also occasions when the Pattachitrakars carried their painted scrolls and also sang parallel songs with the same episodes. The present day study in the context of folk art as an indication towards the perception of viewing and appreciating artworks to connect the comprehensive art critic, the artworks created by this artist not educated in academic style in urban art schools, also who inherit the skill and carry it through the generations, may seem to contain elements in them that are ageless and primitive, or could even be crude or amateurish. They are far beyond the responsibilities of the representational norms of realism and naturalism, and can be totally idealistic and simplified in nature. But folk art begins a community practice almost every to its inhabitants of the cluster has certain level of skills, but only a few qualified to be the master. The rest of the people perform as followers to contribute to the process as skilled craftsmen. So here we should also realize a very crucial point, that when we look at the practice as a community practice, we must also know that not everybody in the community is masterminding a style of expression through their art, but everybody is familiar with that skill set, and most of the people can participate this kind of a creation. So it's a group activity with no doubt, but there are only a few heads who can be identified as the mastermind for this creations. The other people are just skilled laborers who would learn the thing from them and contribute as apprentice, and later they may master the skill, but it's not necessary that all of them can master the skill and think innovatively. So in a way, we should also know that it's part of the society where everybody is familiar with a language, and this is also the cultural context that we discussed in our previous lecture that makes it more effective as a mode of communication in a confined society. And then the aesthetic value of it goes beyond it and becomes universal.